Belly that to
be. Is she?
Hey there, how you doing, bro?
Oh, look up.
How you doing, man?
You what? Where you at? Stand up. Stand up.
Thank you.
Deacon from North Shores, Deacon Ben Crawley, and we'll have prayer followed by Reverend Jones from Ebenezer Missionary Baptist Church.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning, brothers and sisters.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's truly a blessing to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Every time we get a chance to gather with some more saints, we ought to rejoice and be glad.
All right. Amen. All right.
There's a whole lot of mess going on out there.
All right.
Just thank God. My scripture will be coming from Psalms 37.
All right.
Out of the New Testament. And it reads as
Old Testament.
Those that stand for the reading of the book. And it reads as follows. Do not fret because of evil doers, nor be envious of the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass.
Mm-hmm.
And wither as the green herb.
Uh-huh.
Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart.
All right.
Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. May the Lord add a blessing to the hearing, to the readers, and more so to the doers of his word.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Lord, you are the source of my supply. Lord,
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. It is a joy and a pleasure to have you all come together this morning as we lift up the Lord. Amen. I thank each and every one of you for taking time out of your Saturday to come and to fellowship with us on today. I pray that there is a song sung. I pray that there is a scripture read. But most importantly, I pray that the word that is given by these gentlemen touch your hearts, touch your minds, and evoke a change. You welcome once in the name of the Father. You welcome twice in the name of the Son. And you welcome three times in the name of the Holy Ghost. God bless you and enjoy yourself.
Good morning.
Good morning. Say, Sister Pastor.
We're going to go back.
All right.
If I had wings.
All right. Now sing that song, girl.
I'm
were a part of the brotherhood together. Was part of the finance committee there at the church together. He was the guy that took me in, and again, from that time, like I said, I appreciate it. My brother, like I said, I'm down here, but again, whatever you may need, just give me a call. But again, our first one will be look up Deacon Roy Graham. Our second speaker after that would follow would be Deacon Reginald Kirtland of Free Will Missionary Baptist Church. He is the Southwest District Layman President.
All right.
Glad to get him here this morning. We'll follow in that order again. Look up, and then we'll get up. Is that all right?
All right. meet you there.
Oh, yes.
So be encouraged, my brothers. The Lord is coming back.
Amen.
Look up.
Yeah.
Look up. The Lord is coming back. That's what the Bible says. Mm-hmm. Look up. Our redemption draws nigh.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, brother, read your Bible. The Bible says acronyms are basic instructions before they be
learned.
Brother, let's keep it basic. Let's not get complicated. Let's keep it about Jesus.
Uh-huh.
It's so complicated, but it's really about Jesus.
Bring it home, bring it home.
So my brothers and sisters, look up. Both to abound and to suffer need.
Yeah. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me.
Yes,
Paul learned firsthand how to draw on the strength of Christ. He was given a thorn in the flesh, as we know that he was given a thorn in the flesh because he said he was a man called up into the third heaven and had a vision. And the visions were so great so that he wouldn't be exalted above measure. He was given a thorn in the flesh. God knows how to keep us humble. So he was given a thorn in the flesh. He prayed three times that it would go away. But Jesus told him, my grace is sufficient for you. So he learned that in his weakness, that's when Christ's strength would give him the fortitude to go through.
All right.
That's what we have to draw on.
Amen.
To be faithful to the call, to put our hands to the plow and not look back, to hear the Lord say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Jesus, having no sin of his own, went to Calvary's cross. He was beaten before, crown of thorns put on his head, spat on, hit over the head with a reed, had no sins for him to be guilty of. We know the wages of sin was death. Jesus had no sins but ours. So he took it upon himself, and he went to Calvary's cross. Without a mumbling word, he was accused, but he never answered his accusers. And so it was that he was crucified between two thieves. And so when he had hung there between the two thieves, they began to break the legs of the two thieves because it was the day of the Sabbath was coming on. So they break their legs. And when they came to Jesus, they found he was already dead. But yet they pierced him in the side and the blood and the water came out.
Yes, sir.
And so they took him down off of their cross and put him in a borrowed tomb.
Yes.
But on the third day morning,
yes, he did.
He got up.
All right.
With all power in his hands.
All right.
He told his disciples, he says, now that I have authority, you go and make disciples, teaching them all things that I have taught you. And so that comes down to us. If we're going to go and make disciples, we have to get up. You know, the trials of this world will weigh you down. You know, we get tested throughout our life. Faith, you have to have the faith to persevere through whatever. You have to, as the brother said, get a rhema word. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Greater is he that's in me that's in the world. You know, this too shall pass. You know, we have to continue to fight the good fight of faith like he told Timothy. Paul said, I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I'm ready to be offered up. So at the end of this journey, we know that there's a day coming when we all will get up. 1 Thessalonians 4 says, dead in Christ shall rise first, and we that are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet in the air. Thank you, and God bless you.
And bless you.
All right. All right. Can I have another selection?
Praise the Lord. The song that I'm about to sing is called Thank You, Lord, for Your Blessings on Me.
Come on, sister, let us sing that.
Above me, I have a good place to book a place to sleep.
All right.
Food on my table and shoes on my feet.
Right.
You gave me your love and a beautiful family.
Valentine, you need to take a sabbatical. I said, what, God? sure?
He said, yes, sir. You need to take a sabbatical. Now, I've been doing the youth ministry across 3 churches in the past 17 years. Never have I taken a sabbatical. I know it is biblical, okay? If I went to my senior pastor of the Rock Church and said, hey, Pastor Miles, I'm going to go on a 3-month sabbatical, he'd say, Brother Valentin, amen. We'll see you in 3 months. We're going to be praying for you. So I know it'd be, you know, not a big deal, okay? But I just don't feel like I need to take a sabbatical. Have I taken a Sunday off here and there? Of course. You know, I have a family function that I'm going to be at. Maybe World Cup soccer's going on during church hours. So I don't want to watch the replay at night. So I want to watch it live. So I'll stay home. For sure. For sure. I'll stay home. You know? But a full-on sabbatical? Never. So I'm kind of just like wrestling with God. I'm like, God, I really don't want to do this. I don't want to. I don't feel like I have to. As y'all know, we need to do our best to be obedient to the Lord.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm fighting having this conversation with the children's pastor at the Rock Church, right? I'm going week after week seeing him, right, and not saying a word and say, hey, Pastor Jeremy, can we talk for a second? This is what the Lord put on my heart. So finally, I go to him about a month and a half later. After God says, Valentin, do this. Be obedient to me and do this. So I pulled him and said, Pastor, this is what God said. I got to go in 3 months to battle. Okay, sounds good. When are you going to start this? With hesitation, I say, maybe October, November-ish? And he said, Valentin, stop. You just told me that you clearly heard from the Lord that you need to take a sabbatical. And you clearly heard it's 3 months. So I'm going to do you a favor. Okay, I'm going to help you out. You're going to take your sabbatical starting October, and you're going to come back in January. Okay? I said, okay. So he basically made the decision for me. Okay? Now, the scripture that I want to discuss for a few seconds here is out of James chapter 1, verse 19. And I'm reading out of the New International Version, because I know for some people, they like to know. It says this, my dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry. Now that last portion we're just going to leave out to the side. But I want to focus on 2 key phrases in that scripture. Okay? Be quick to listen. See, I wasn't quick to listen. Okay? I wasn't quick to listen at all. I didn't stop and sit down and really, like, hear what God is trying to tell me. Valentin, you gotta take a sabbatical. I was just like, God, I don't want to do it. You know, like, because I don't feel like I have to. Okay? So I wasn't being quick to just listen. And that second, phrase, slow to speak. I wasn't slow to speak. I quickly said, no, God, not me. You mean not me, not right now. I'm not ready. You know, like, I don't feel I have to. Okay? But as we know, fam, like, we need to be obedient to the Lord.
Yes.
Okay? So, after the children's pastor, Pastor Jeremy, kind of basically made that decision for me, that's when I started to really now in my prayer time during this sabbatical that I'm in from children's ministry, from teaching the word to our youth, our next generation, as cheesy as that may sound, I'm asking God, okay, God, you need to show me something. Like, what are you trying to teach me? Okay, because now I got it, God, I got it. Like, I am now listening.
Mm-hmm.
And I am now slow to speak. So teach me something, God. Show me something. And one of the things that he showed me, basically, was, young saint, I was just trying to get you to shut up.
Yeah.
I was just trying to get you to shut up. Because I want to show you something. Now, you haven't heard from me yet. That's okay, but just shut up, young saint. Because I want to teach you something. I want to show you something. So moving forward now, I now think to myself, or I say to myself, be slow to speak. So when our light bills run late, right? Or our car note, like we don't know where it's gonna, you know, where that money's gonna come to pay it, right? You know, we gotta just be quick to listen, slow to speak, because God's gonna get it anyway. So young saint, young daughter of the King, moving forward, always be quick to listen, slow to speak, and ask God, God, what is going on? Like, how am I gonna do this? So basically, God was just telling me, shut up. Just shut up and rely on me. Don't worry about what's happening with the children's ministry. Don't worry about how many people you need to be there for you. Because, for the record, we're short. I'm up here. But God was like, just telling me, shut up. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's going to be okay. Don't worry about it. Everything is going to take care of itself. Thank you. That's my time.
The Reverend Jerry B. Moten.
Bless you, Roger.
Pleasure to be here, sir.
Thanks. Come on, Roger, man.
And by the way, you're a Bethel, and a Bethel emeritus.
Yes, sir.
You
yes,
come to just see. Thank you. Yeah. Deacon Gaines, a pleasure. Thank you for having me. And to the members of Ebenezer, it's a joy to be with you once again.
Amen.
To my pastor in absentia, the Reverend Harvey L. Vaughn III, and President Doug Oden, good to be here today. And to my mentor here, the great Hugh Crawford, one of the men of Bethel, who I look up to. I don't have a father. He ran out of me when I was an infant. But it's brothers like Hugh Crawford that made me the man that I am today. Now I know which way to go. And to all our friends and family here today, it's just a blessing to be before you. I thank you for the invitation. I'm going to set my timer because I believe I have 7 minutes, right? I like to talk. So I can keep this thing going. 7 minutes. Here we go. So my word is to speak up. And to give a context, I'm going to go way, way, way back and talk about the plight of the black man in America. The black man in America has had a rough go of it, as we all know. Starting in Africa, when we had things going beautifully, we had our families, our friends, our kingdoms, everything was perfect until the Europeans set foot on our continent and changed things. On the passage to America, many men and women of our color were put in slave ships on the lower decks, chained side to side, brother, sister on the left, on the right, and they were there. Not having a common language, not able to communicate with each other, but they were just there, crying in sorrow. They set foot on American soil, on the continent of North America, initiating and bringing the slave trade and the whole institution of slavery forth in America. Slavery was outlawed in 1865, and we go into the Reconstruction period. Again, the black family, the black man is just there all by himself with no way to go. Which way do we turn? The white people ran off and just left them on the plantations, not knowing which way to turn, left or right. What can we do? Therefore, the sharecropping industry comes up, where blacks are continuously cheated from the profits that they have made through their working the land. From Reconstruction, we go into the Great Migration, where many of us have ancestors who came west and north, seeking a better life for their families. From there, we go into the Civil Rights era of the 50s and 60s. I spoke to a young person a couple of weeks ago, and they said that the Civil Rights era is over. From the Civil Rights era, we go into their era of affirmative action, where government sanctioned jobs are given to black people. And now we see that the affirmative action programs are drying up, and they're not made for us anymore. More and more white women are taking advantage of the affirmative action because they can kill two birds with one stone. And in the 80s, we had the war on drugs. I'm from Los Angeles, so I saw firsthand the crack epidemic, LAPD running in and just wiping people up, putting them in prison. Many of them are still there today. As we have legalized marijuana now, they still sit there in prison, not having hope. But now the drugs are okay, what are we to do? Should we let them out? We should. But notice that during each of these periods of the black existence, there was somebody, one person who spoke
up.
They didn't sit there and take it. They spoke up. They stood up and had to be done. And in history, looking at all those periods, who brought us through? It was God that brought
all
us through.
All right.
It was God who blessed us and edified us in his word. For many slaves didn't know the language, but they learned the language of English by reading their Bibles. They taught each other back and forth the same scriptures that we read today. Amen. And that is how they began their American journey. So, bring us through. God brings us through our situations through prayer. If we ask him to, he'll sanction a vision for us. And he'll bring us around like-minded people with a common faith, goal, and purpose like we're doing here today. Also, there's apprehension. But God didn't give us the spirit of fear. Yet we fear things that we don't understand and things that we don't know. But survival is, and success is inevitable because they stood on the word of God and the promises therein. So in each period of history that I have mentioned, someone took that first step to realize change. Somebody spoke up, somebody stood up, somebody manned up, and somebody shut up.
All right.
So under the protection and sanctity of God Almighty, the vision was blessed and made to go forth. That one person has a vision, prayed upon it, and God blessed that vision and told him or her which way to go. We realize that there's resistance to the vision by man's inhumanity to man as reference to the slave trade earlier. Souls were beaten, murdered, and bombed all throughout our existence, and they're currently going on today with police shootings or young black men and women being killed by a sanctioned government. Yet the vision of God continues to go forth. The vision of God is planted within each and every one of us,
and it
continues. So how did it keep going? Well, since this is a biblical meeting, or biblical service, I should have said, they went under the protection of God. And the protection of God that I'm going to speak of today comes from the 91st Division of Psalms. And I'll read it for you. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely he will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You only will observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. That punishment is on its way, brothers and sisters. If you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord who is my refuge, then no harm will befall you. No disaster will come near your tent. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against the stone. You will tread upon the lion and the cobra, and you will trample the great lion and serpent. How do I know this? How do we know this? It's because, as it says in verse 14, we know because he loves me. He will rescue us. The Lord says, I will rescue him. I will protect him. He acknowledges my name. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. We will be with him in trouble, and I will deliver him and honor him. 7 minutes is up. No, it's time.
Right now. Thank you.
that's all it is, only a love.
Yeah.
Well, now coming to pretty much the end, and you know, something, we got three in a row this time instead of two. We got step up, wake up, stand up.
All right.
Step up, Deacon Harvey Terrell Jr. from New Assurance Baptist Church.
All right.
Have a chance to talk to this brother's energetic.
Uh-huh.
He's running.
We talked again
after this program. We talked, like I said, we got a lot of things that we got coming up together. That, like I said, if he's running, I want to run right alongside.
All right,
because, yeah. Like I said, God's journey needs strong man running.
Yeah, right.
Followed by Wake Up by Deacon Tommy Hannah out of the Pilgrim Progressive.
All right.
This brother is an encouraging brother. When I first met him, I think it was I can't remember what program it was, but again, when I first met him, he always encouraged me. He says, you know, stay with what you're doing, get out, same thing, I was told by a couple other people, get out to some of the programs and meet the brothers. You know, you won't know them if you don't go out. And I appreciate that. Deacon Hannon, every time I call him, he's another one. That if I need something, like he told me, if he can't do it, he'll have somebody in, he can find somebody else, and I truly do appreciate that. Amen. And then lastly, we stand up, and that's by being Gaines, myself right here, Ebenezer. So right now, I'm going to go ahead and wipe it out. All my speakers again, please don't leave. We got some presentations at the end. But right now, we have Step Up, Deacon Harvey, Wake Up, Deacon Hannah, and Stand Up, Deacon Bonnie Gaines.
Amen. Go, Harvey.
First thing I want to do is I want to thank Pastor Mo for allowing me to come.
Bless you, sir.
This week. I want to thank Deacon Gaines for thinking it enough to invite me. I want to thank our chairman, too, because he also invited me to this right here. And I also want to thank everybody from New Assurance that showed up today.
Amen.
And I always say this when I say this, I want to thank my grandfather in ministry, Reverend Martin, for showing up, and then my uncle in ministry, Reverend Pro. And I'm thankful because I know that the Lord has used them to get me where I need to be. I want to be mindful of the time, but I didn't know I got a deposit on three extra minutes. But the text that I want to speak about is in Daniel chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. Most of us know this story about Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. But today I want to shine some light on a couple of things in this text. In Daniel, we read about three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These three men, with Daniel, had been appointed to authority positions in Babylon. We know that. We know that Daniel was given the gift to foretell dreams, okay? They were godly Jews, most whom had been given the knowledge and skill of wisdom and understanding. And whom God had furthered in these authority positions. The great thing about this is God had furthered these to position. Because of their positions, they would probably enjoy more things than not only the Jews, but also more than the natives would, okay, would enjoy. They were certainly blessed people. Amen? They were certainly blessed people. However, one day the situation changed. They were brought before the king, Nebuchadnezzar, and commanded to bow down and worship the king's golden image. At the sound of the instruments.
Yeah.
Okay. King Nebuchadnezzar, he was a king of Babylon. He sent out a decree for all the offices and the province to dedicate to this statue that he wanted everyone to bow down to. And all bowed down to, except Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. And when they didn't do that, there were some people that had a problem with that. Mm-hmm. It says that the Chaldeans went and told. Said all bow down to this image, except for Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. They were forced. They wanted them. They forced people to try to deny God. How many people here know that sometimes you're going to be forced to deny God? It may not be this way, but it may be in another way. On your job, in your relationship, family members, you may be forced to deny God when it's time to go to the club. You may be forced to deny God when it's to do something that is not biblical,
right?
Okay? But you have to make sure that you do not let anyone force you to deny God. Do not use the pressure to deny God. Step up.
All right.
And do not deny God.
All
amen.
Right. Amen.
Verse 16 says, Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego answered the king and said, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
How many people here know that you can't even entertain some of that stuff? You have no need to make a claim why you don't want to go to the club or the strip club, for that matter, mm-hmm. or anything else mm-hmm. that is ungodly, anything that Christians don't do. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And so they stood up, and they would not allow themselves to be pressured to deny God. Verse 17, they were determined to step up. So not only do you have to step up, you have to be determined to step up.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 17 says, if that's the case, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from mm-hmm. the fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand.
Mm-hmm.
Whose hand is that? Saints, whose hand is that? Anybody's hands that is not in God's hands. Anybody that is not operating in the will of God. You have to understand that this world is full of things that will turn you away from God. But you have to be determined to step up for what is right.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be determined to tell the truth about all matters.
Yeah.
You have to be determined to step up and stick to the word of God, no matter what the people around you are saying or what people think. Which brings me to verse 18. Whether or not they like it or not, but if not, let it be known to you, O King, people of the world, unchristian-like people, people that frown because you're a Christian, that we do not serve your gods, the money, the cars, the house, the sex, the drugs, nor will we worship this golden image which you have set up. Daniel 3:28 says, they delivered their bodies to worship him. Certainly the Lord's work. It takes energy.
Mm-hmm.
You have to step up to serve the Lord. You cannot be a believer in the kingdom of God. You have to step up and make it to Sunday school. You have to step up and make it to prayer meetings. You have to step up and make it to Sunday service, whether the football game's on or not. You have to get there. And for you men in here, every time a man comes to Christ, his whole house get blessed. So it's important that we remember that. It's important that we remember that. The king was furious. He was angry. Their reply made the king even angrier. They said, turn it up seven times more. Turn it up seven times more. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were immediately bound and cast into the furnace. Yet something unexpected happened. The king and the counselors were astonished. How many people here know you? People are going to be astonished when you go from a life of crimes, drugs, and alcohol, and God delivers you and he sets you on high.
All right, all right.
But it's not for you. It's not for them. It's for the glory of God.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. So step up. Step up.
Reach on it.
They were cast into the fire. They looked in. And immediately the king commanded, take them out. Take them out. He said, take them out. Thank God he said, take me out of the streets.
Right.
He said, take them out. The response recorded in verse 28 said, blessed be the God of Meshach, Shadrach, Abednego, and Dethar-Meshurael. All right.
All right.
Blessed be the God.
Yeah. All right.
Blessed be that God. That same God. I thank you every single day. Again. So I want to stay mindful to the time, and I will leave you with something. In closing, I will leave you with something.
Come on, Harvey.
Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, they would not bend, bow, or burn.
All right.
Don't allow yourselves to bend, bow, or burn out there in the streets with your family.
Harvey.
Sometimes it'll be your loved ones that will be going against God, but you have to show patience, but you cannot bend, bow, or burn.
That's right.
And these are some of the reasons why I love the story about Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. Because they stepped up and never denied the true and living God. They stepped up and trusted God through their trials and tribulations. How many people here know that you got to do that?
Yeah. All right.
They stepped up and were determined not to worship an idol. And I like this because this came out of our deacon class. They stepped up and told the truth about all matters, whether people like it or not.
Yeah.
When it comes to the words, you tell the truth.
Yeah.
There's going to be some people that are not going to like it.
Yeah.
But you have to step up. You have to step up for what is right.
Yeah.
Let the Bible be your authority.
Amen.
Step up
for the Bible.
And it's also one last thing I'm going to leave you with. Step up and give God the praise and the glory that only you deserve. Because we don't deserve none of it. Mm-hmm. It all belongs to Him. Every time I stand before somebody, I pray, God, humble me down, humble me down, humble me down, God, so you get it and I don't.
All right.
But I will step up every time it comes to Him. And I encourage the men and women inside this sanctuary right now to step up for God. Amen.
All right. All right.
Don't charge Tommy, this is on me.
because that would have took up 3 minutes and 41 seconds of my time.
All right.
Wake up.
Okay.
Concerns that offer a thought-provoking question that should highlight a Christian's response. Times has changed from the beginning of time and will continue to change. What are we going to tell God about how we let our children get away?
Hmm.
How are we going to explain? How are we going to explain to God how we didn't train or teach them in the way that they should go?
My Lord.
In 1975, Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes released a song called Wake Up Everybody.
Yeah.
Even though the song was released over 40 years ago, the lyrics are still timely in this time and age.
Amen.
The lyrics say, wake up everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more backward thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There is so much hatred and war and property. My focus is on wake up all the teachers. Deuteronomy 6, verse 4 through 7 reads, hear, O Israel, let's put ourselves in Israel's place. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. And thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. This passage of scripture lets us know that there are some things that need to be done at home.
All right.
When thou sittest down, when thou liest down, when thou risest up, all these things are taking place at home.
Yes.
So when you get a chance, teach your children about the word.
All right.
The Psalms say teachers. I'm going to talk about fathers too. Because we're the father figures. We are the teachers. We're the men of the house. Okay? The Psalms says teachers. Time to teach a new way. It's not saying teach a new word or a new gospel. It already told us the way we're supposed to teach them. When they lay it down, and wake it up. Like the brother said, back in the days, we didn't have no choice. We already knew what we were doing next Sunday.
All right.
We go home from church, we put our church clothes up. Nowadays, they just don't want anything from the church. We have been warned. So shall the knowledge of wisdom be unto thy soul when thou hast found it. Then there shall be a reward, and then thy expectations shall not be cut off. That's Proverbs 24:14. The song continues. We can't do it alone. We need help. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. The times have changed. We have to come together. It's telling the teachers to wake up. Builders, doctors, if you know the song, it goes on. Dope users, stop using dope. Dope users, stop pushing the dope. Preachers, preach what you teach. It goes on. Businessmen, stop cheating. Politicians, stop lying. You know, we have to wake up.
All right.
The world won't get no better if we just let it be.
My Lord.
It's time to wake up.
All right.
Thank you.
All right. All right. All right. All right. All right. All right, Dan, bring it home.
Uh-oh. Good job, D.
Huh?
I'm going to
I'm like big and ham, like I said, I'm like, I should have. I should have first. Mine's a stand up, and mine's going to be stand up to be a strong man in the church.
All right.
I'm going to come from Ephesians, the 6th chapter, verses 10 through 13. And it reads as follows. Finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand him, withstand in the evil day, and have done all to stand. Now, my brothers, I'm going to talk about what we normally see when we see man come into the church. A lot of times we see man come into the church. They come into the church, let's be honest, for the wrong reasons. Some come into the church for money. Some men come into the church looking for a woman, let's be real. Some men come into church looking for power. But you have to ask yourself, come on, can the church, what can the church do for me? But you really need to be asking yourself, what can I do for the church?
Come on, man.
Now, I'm going to try to give you a good little formula on what I think it is about standing up being a strong man in the church. Now, you may agree, you may disagree, but I'm going to try to give you a good formula.
Come on, D.
Now, my brothers, we feed our bodies with this high-protein diet, and we diet. We tone our bodies, we go to the gym, flex the muscles, and we're trying to get strong, you know, look good. But what we need to partake in is the soul food.
Come on. All right, all right.
And when I say soul food, I ain't talking about the chicken and the ham hocks. I'm talking about the soul.
All right.
Exercises and our spiritual muscles.
Yeah.
Again, ain't the physical muscles, but the spiritual muscles.
All right.
To be strong in the church, you must be balanced. Mm-hmm. You must truly be able to pray. Right. And when I say be balanced, like I said, you know some churches, like I said, some folks make you act. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You got the folks. So you got to be balanced and you got to be strong. And you got to be in prayer at all times. Do we remember, like I said, David was a man after God's own heart. For us to become man after God's own heart, it does not require perfection. It requires a passionate heart, an honest conscience, and the perseverance to keep seeking him even when we fail.
All right.
While we're out here trying to get every special approval from everybody else in the church, we have to remember one thing. It was Jesus that died for us.
All right.
So we're worrying about what everybody else is saying. But like I said, we ought to be worrying about who died for us. He is the only one who we ought to be seeking his approval.
That's right.
When I come to church every Sunday, like I said again, I do what says the Lord. I'm not here to impress sister so-and-so, brother so-and-so, whatever. I'm here to do what the Lord has asked me to do. When it comes to our need for grace and mercy, all men must come to the cross and confess their needs to God. A lot of times we confessing our needs to everything else. You know, we worried about, you know, confessing the need for a brand new car, and confessing these new shoes, I need a sharp outfit, but we need to confess it to the Lord. The Lord is the one that, like I said, puts us in those positions to get whatever we've had.
All right.
And in conclusion, and like I said again, I'm trying to talk fast because, like I said, my time watching. But in conclusion, they say real men pump arms. They say real men run the show. They say real men lose the women. They say real men got swagger. They say real men never cry. But I'm here to tell you, real men should open up
Amen.
To their real friends. Right. Real men should cherish their wives and kids.
Right.
Real men should read the Bible daily.
All right.
Real men should pray. Amen. And last but not least, real men should kneel at the cross. Speakers, but before then, I want to ask Deacon Calvin Armstrong from the Sweet Home Missionary Baptist Church, he's the Western State Baptist Convention late president. If he'd like to say a word, he traveled the farthest, I think, coming from El Centro and and he's another one. Like I said, if I asked him, like I said, he's always busy. He's always busy. And like I said again, I get to be like Deacon Armstrong. Like I said, I wouldn't be that same. I want to be busy. I want to be sitting around. All right. I want to be busy. And like I said, I knew Deacon Armstrong before. He was a teacher at Plexico High School. He was a football coach. I always heard about Deacon Armstrong, track coach. You know, you want your kids to do whatever, you send them to Deacon Armstrong. And I'm thinking, Deacon Armstrong, and I seen him at church, and you never put two and two together. But like I said, this brother right here, like I said again, not only is he a teacher and a football, but like I said, if you go to the Vacation Bible Schools in Imperial Valley, he's a heck of a teacher. Like I said, and again, he's a man of his word, but I'm not trying to put him on the spot, but I'd like if he could get up and say a word real quick. And then also, I think there's a Laban thing coming up in June. I don't know if you have a date or not, but if he could say a quick word before we give out our presentation.
Thank you, Brother Gaines.
Bless you, sir.
Other pastors that are here today. Friends and see Robert Edison here earlier. He's still here. And down from Imperial Valley. It's just good to be here. And Brother Gaines has called me on the other day and has provided me help. He didn't tell me what to wear. So I normally, when I have my state meetings, I wear like you have. Anyway, God blesses all of us.
Amen.
The scripture tells us that each one bear his own. Let each one test his own works, because each man will have his own load to bear. And I know you're here today because you're bearing that load. Okay? So if we look at Galatians 4, 6 and 4 and 5, we will see what God is telling us to do, to bear our load. And that's what it's going to take for us to do that. Gaines has been running. And appreciate that because I was telling somebody on the phone, I said, well, but he was from an AME church. And now he's at a Baptist church. Right. Said, but the work goes on. It doesn't matter which one you come from.
That's right.
It is about the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And right. I enjoy the speakers from the other churches that came to present themselves. I'm aware of the names of the churches, but I haven't met many of those men from some of those churches. So we have great work to do. Whether we're on the football field, the track, we need to tell our students and others around us about Christ. That's the main event that we need to do. And I see men lacking in the church, lacking their responsibilities statewide. And it's embarrassing to me that men won't stand up in Christ. It's embarrassing. But as Brother Gaines says, I do have an event, two events is coming up, and some of you can participate in either one. One of them's here in San Diego. We have a prayer breakfast every year in San Diego at Bethel Baptist Church. Dr. John Ringo is the pastor. And we have that in the second week of February. And we'd like to invite you to that prayer breakfast. It starts at 8 o'clock in the morning with the breakfast prepared by the men of Bethel. It's $10. And then this year we're going to have our main speaker, who is going to be Dr. D.C. Green, who is a moderator of Southwest District. But he's leaving us, and he's going to go back to Atlanta, Georgia, and enjoy his retired life. So anyway, he's going to be the speaker that morning. So we invite you over to Bethel on the second Saturday of January, starting to be with Bob, Deacon Kirkland, and Deacon here will both have tickets. They'll both have tickets for that event. So if you want tickets, they'll have them. The second event is we have in April. This is called the Far West Workshop. It's put on by the Baptist denomination, but it doesn't matter. We have all people of all denominations attend the workshop. And the workshop is going to be held April the 17th in San Mateo, California. And we normally have five states represented in that workshop. And we have over 300 delegates, men and their wives. Some of our children have a basketball tournament there. Could represent Southwest District, the district that we're in. But anyway, we have that at San Mateo. It's a 3-day event. It starts on Friday with our youth. All of it's about youth. Friday evening, and then Saturday we have workshops for our men and our women, and then we let out Sunday morning. So I invite you, if you would like to join those things, there will be flyers out by the same men that I just mentioned that we have. So God, have all the blessings, we give him all the glory for what he's done for us, and it's just good to be here this morning with you. And again, I want to thank you for that. Thank you.
I'd like to thank Reverend Martin for coming. I'd like to thank Reverend Crowe, amen. Deacon Armstrong, bless you. Appreciate you coming all the way that you did, amen. Also to Sister Lasker, God bless you. Good to see you, amen. Now, I just want to say this before I close. The Bethel, Free Will, The Rock, New Assurance, Rising Star, Pilgrim, Ebenezer, and other churches that are represented that I don't know about. It's time for us to stand up, speak up, wake up. We must go to work. We must be about our Father's business. We must take it very seriously. People are dying in this world because people are refusing to speak the word of God. We have a president in the White House right now that knows nothing about God. But check this out. All we have to do is pray. Pray about this situation, amen? Grab a hold of a young man and a young woman and encourage them in the Lord. And if you do that, the whole world would be a different place, amen? So we have our charge. You all know what you need to do, amen? Let's go about that business, amen? At this time, I'd like to call each one of the speakers up. I'm going to call you by name. Come on, big gang. Starting here. I'd like Deacon Reginald Kirkland to come forward, please. Gracious and eternal God, Father, Lord, we love you. Lord, we lift you up and we magnify you. Father, we thank you for this program, Lord. We thank you for every speaker. We thank you for what they seeded in our hearts and in our minds, Lord. We pray now in the name of Jesus that you would send us forth, O Father God, that we may make disciples out of men, women, boys, and girls, O Father. We pray in the name of Jesus that you would anoint each one of these men, O Father God. Send them forth with power, O Father, to change lives. Lord, I pray for those that were here, O Father God, and then for those that did not participate but were active listeners, O Father God. Father, I pray now in the name of Jesus that you would bless the food that we're about to receive for the nourishment of our bodies. I pray that you would bless the hands of the parent. Lord, as we leave this place, I pray we never leave your presence. It is in the body, matchless name of Jesus, we can pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Yes, sir. Oh, what's your name? I love you. What's your name?